How do we use artificial intelligence to truly transform human health, to make aging optional, to make disease a thing of the past? How do we do that? The way to do that is to start with causality. And causality is very hard in human epidemiology. The vast majority of data is about correlations. But the one place where causality is there is genetics. So we start with genetic information, which basically tells us across the 6 million common variants that all of us have inherited from our mom and our dad, which ones are associated with disease. That allows us to know that there's something causal going on there, but that doesn't tell us how it works. The beauty and the power of genetics is that it doesn't matter what genes are made of, it doesn't matter if they're made of green cheese, genetics will still work. But the challenge is that after you have the genetic kit, you have no idea how it works. You have no idea what cell type, what gene might be the target, what tissue of action, the mechanism is simply unknown. And how do you develop therapeutics without mechanism? So the way that we do that is by systematically starting from genetics and then profiling the molecular impact of those genetic differences at the cellular level. To basically understand, for example, for patients that show Alzheimer's, how is APOE4 impacting the brain? And not just the brain as a whole, but every single cell type of the brain. So what we need to do is understand the molecular impact of every one of those genetic variants at single cell resolution in every tissue and every cell type of the body. That's where AI begins. AI begins with data. So we have the genetics, we have the molecular phenotypes, we can now start integrating the data sets together. And we can basically ask, what are the driver genes, regulatory control regions, and cell types that are mediating the effect of the genetic variants? It doesn't matter if you carry the genetic variant, you carry the circuit, whether or not you have the variant. And that basically means that we can intervene for everyone in this room, even if only two people contain the specific genetic variant associated with obesity, Alzheimer's, cardiovascular disease, and so on and so forth. So once we've integrated all these data, we then make predictions about what is driving the disease, and then we go and change these elements. We perturb them. The beauty of circuits is that you can then intervene. And we, for example, did this for the strongest genetic association with obesity. So I carry two copies. Thank you both, mom and dad. They basically gave me a risk allele for obesity. And that basically means that if you look at my circuit, there's something going on there. And what changes is not the genes directly. What changes instead is individual nucleotides that are sometimes affecting genes that are far, far away. And that's what we've uncovered here. We've basically found that underlying the strongest association with obesity lies a circuit that ultimately controls whether your fat cells will burn calories that you don't consume through the day, that you don't use through the day, or whether they will store them for a rainy day. And the storing allele is great if you're living in food-deprived societies. But in today's world where we have office jobs and McDonald's and cookies outside in the break, you basically don't want to store every calorie. So by understanding these circuits, we can now start intervening. So we've basically developed methods for changing the upstream or the downstream target genes from these regulators. We can also go with genome editing, with CRISPR-Cas9 genome editing, and change that single nucleotide letter that makes me at risk for obesity. And what we find in every one of those cases is that when we understand the circuits, we can intervene like a switch. We can flip ourselves back and forth between thermogenic, burning calories, and lipogenic, storing fat. And what we saw is that with a single letter alteration out of 3 billion letters of the human genome, we can basically flip the switch and restore thermogenesis in fat cells from individuals like myself. We can also go into mice and change that circuit to downregulate the genes that get derepressed when humans have this allele. And what we find is a dramatic shift where mice simply cannot gain weight. You put them on a high-fat diet, normal mice gain weight. These mice are unable to gain weight. So they can exercise as little as they want. They can sleep as much as they want. They just simply don't put on calories. So if you guys want some pills for that, I have them in the back. So that's one example for obesity. What's another great killer of our time? Alzheimer's disease. So again, with an aging population, Alzheimer's has become extremely important. And the previous variant that I showed you increases your obesity risk by one standard deviation. Here, this increases your risk by a factor of 10. Homozygous risk for APOE4 have tenfold higher risk. Again, doing the single cell dissection, understanding the circuitry, we found that APOE4 controls the transport of lipids, and specifically myelinating cholesterol, through oligodendrocytes. These are the cells of your brain that protect the neurons. And the cholesterol gets stuck in the endoplasmic reticulum. It doesn't make it all the way to myelin to protect the neurons. So by understanding the circuitry, we said, okay, great, let's restore transport. And we found that it restores myelination, and it also restores cognition in the mice. We have some of that on behind the other door. So here's a third example by Jackie, who's actually sitting at the back of the room over there. So basically, by looking at a cohort of immunotherapy patients, some of whom respond and some of whom do not respond to immunotherapy for metastatic melanoma, we basically were able to predict a regulator that sits upstream of the non-responders, and we're able to overexpress that regulator and suddenly use a combination therapy that restores the effects of immunotherapy for all patients. So that's what we want to do systematically for every disease. So how do we do that? It starts with big data. We basically start with understanding the genome systematically, understanding the regulatory control circuitry, being able to map where are the genetic variants across thousands of diseases and thousands of tissues, and being able to build these maps that tell us what tissue is every disease acting in based on the overlap between the control regions of that tissue and the genetic variants associated with that disease. We can then understand the causality through mediation analysis, Mendelian randomization, and other approaches to understand how genetic variants are acting through these intermediate molecular phenotypes to be able to predict the impact in the brain based on, at 93 years of age, based on the genetic variants that you have when you are first born. So we're able to, for 50,000 loci, start predicting the epigenome, predicting the regulatory state of your cells. And we can use this to discover new disease loci that are causal in the disease circuitry. We can then go at single cell resolution, and we have written a series of grants in my group to understand cardiac disease, obesity, 12 different neurodegenerative disorders, ALS, FTD, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, autism. And for all of those, we're basically looking at cohorts of individuals working with clinics, working with doctors, working with patients to get samples to then understand how are these changing at single cell resolution. What that allows us to do is now start asking about the progression of disease. We can treat every cell as being in a different stage on the progression from non-AD to AD and start understanding what are the genetic variants that are acting early or late in the disease progression. We can go at single cell resolution and start mapping, even in subcellular resolution, the spatial organization of where are these genes expressed and where are they differentially expressed in the context of complex tissues to try to understand the networks that are guiding, in this particular case, cardiac disorders and coronary artery disease and heart failure, which we are finding are in fact altering the expression of foam cells, macrophages, that engulf the lipids that your fat cells are not able to store and that are now going into your veins, which are the driver of the number one cause of mortality, which is, of course, cardiac arrest. We can then start asking about the impact, not just in one tissue, but in multiple tissues simultaneously. We can basically take cohorts of humans and mice, subject them to diet and exercise interventions, and then see how those are in fact changing multiple tissues in the body simultaneously, and what are the cells and circuits that are mediating the beneficiary effects of exercise so that we can then go and alter those circuits and recapitulate the effects of exercise for people who might be bedridden or simply not have the time. We have some pills of that up there as well. We can then start asking, can we understand the diversity of disease? Can we understand now how we can use these hallmarks that we're finding? Across hundreds of individuals, we can basically see the subsets of cells that are turning on and off repeatedly in different patients, and how they turn on and off in combinations across those patients. And we can use that to start understanding the subtypes of patients. And what we're finding is that at the transcriptional level, when you look at gene expression alone, we can start predicting differences between patient subgroups that also manifest, that are visible at the phenotypic level. So individuals that show differences in their cells are also showing differences in their phenotype. This is extremely important because for the cells, we can actually start using molecular information to predict the subtype of that individual. We don't want to say, oh, please give us a sample of your brain and then we'll tell you which drug to take, because people kind of like to hold on to their brain. But instead, we can genetically start predicting the impact of these genetic variants and then start predicting which patient subgroup everyone should belong in. So we're using all this to now develop target genes, and we're using next generation technologies for modulating this in programmable and modular ways so that we can go in and activate or repress individual regulatory regions or individual genes or individual variants, and we can carry this out systematically. And we now have this amazing collaboration that's using large language models to predict the protein language, or the language of protein folding, the language protein function, the language of gene expression through separate towers, these foundational models, and then glue them together in the same multidimensional embedding so that we can translate seamlessly between the type of therapeutic that you need for every type of function. And we can use this to now transform medicine. We can use this to enable personalized medicine, to understand the drivers, to develop drugs specifically for these drivers. And this requires a call to action. This requires a coalition across every single discipline represented in this room, across computer science, biology, chemistry, engineering, finance, as we heard earlier. So the last place where AI is making a dramatic difference is the discovery process itself. So a small team in my lab has now started working on this idea navigator that allows us to now project every idea through every meeting that we have across an entire organization, across years of work, across multiple different teams working on different aspects, and connect people together when they're working on the same ideas. At the top right, you can see an example of embedding 150,000 papers that have cited our work. At the bottom, 10,000 meetings that we've had that have been automatically transcribed, connecting them, dragging them together, and seeing how individual ideas traverse through the space of the work in our own lab. And I'm hoping that you can use that for your own corporation. And this one, we actually do have it at the back of the room. So I just want to thank this extraordinary team of individuals, many of whom are here in the room, for the opportunity to work on all these different topics. And I want to thank John for putting together just such an awesome meeting. And thank you all for coming.